Mounds in Illinois. Powerful place, powerful energy. We're at one of the largest mounds here, which are basically pyramids, you know, where they found several artifacts where they only said were in West Africa, you know, ancient relics. There are also parts in the park that I mentioned before where they're able to tell time, like basically a large sundial. They're able to predict like seasonal events off of certain areas. And the energy here is just really, really high. And knowing that our ancestors were a part of something so big, you know, so ingenious is amazing. Basically standing on top of a pyramid. So we're gonna get us some good vibes, do some meditations, and take advantage of these vibes. Let me tell y'all something about this place. There are jet pillars all around this place. And not to mention, like I said, the pyramids are here. It's, you know, it's really, really a mirror image of Kemet. What?
Thank you.
So all this stuff just repeats. We carry on the tradition and the legacy. Just like a tingling all the way up. I wonder what the science is behind the juxtaposition of the arch, the gateway to, you know, this central part of the mound. It's like, I mean, it's on the horizon. I'm sure there's some type of correlation between where that was built and where the mounds are located. Calling attention, I say I go, y'all say I may. I go.
Ame.
I go.
Ame.
I go.
Ame.
I go. Ame. I don't want to on your coupon, on Ponquame. Your cherry wants you, not your ma wants you. As I say, I'm Ponyama, I would dear moa, or some may a journey dear. May be wa, me dime. Metty, I say, me dime. Dread, damnifadre.
LCO, Halito. It is Raven Redtail Hog Jaguar, and I'm here at the Cahokia Mounds here in Collinsville, Illinois, right outside of St. Louis. I'm here with my daughter. She has left me, but that's okay. All right, this is what we see when we get here. All right, the City of the Sun. That's what that means, Cahokia. All right. And we have our ancestors doing long distance trade, okay, with many exotic materials, okay, and markets. So this was like the marketplace, okay. All right. This is so cool. I'm so thankful. I'm so grateful. This was the largest prehistoric Indian community in America, in north of Mexico, okay? This is awesome, okay? All right, now, they have another little thing here. It's the oldest city, okay? Right, stretched from Illinois to Pennsylvania. All right, the road that built the nation. All right, so I'm walking along. My daughter, she is up there if you see her. I love her, even though she's crazy and she left me. But I'm so excited to see the historic mounds of the Mississippian culture. My ancestors came from the Mississippian culture. All right, peace. I'll see y'all in a minute. So where the Grand Plaza is. All right. Daily life activities. The heart of the city. All right. I'm so thankful and grateful to be here at this time to witness where our ancestors dwelled and what they did here. These ancient mounds. This is really special to me. This is my birthday present to myself. Right, if you can see over there, you see that grand big baby over there. That mound is huge. It's massive. All right, wow. Let me see if I can zoom in so you can see. Yeah, you see that baby right there? Yeah. See you in a minute. Here at the Cahokia Mounds, the Monk's Mound, which is the largest mound. We're about to head up. All right, me and my daughter. And ooh, you can't really see it, but you can see it. You see, it's massive. Yeah, baby. It's massive. I'm so excited. About to climb those stairs, baby. Gonna be a little challenge, but that's all right, because I am here to experience what my ancestors did, what they built. See you, baby. See you in a minute. Here at the Cahokia Mounds, the City of the Sun, and I'm about to climb the Monk's Mound with my daughter. That's only a portion of it in the background. You see. All right. All right. We're headed up, baby. I made it some way up. I got a little far to go, but I'm here, baby. Yeah, for my ancestors. The Mississippian culture, the salute. It's huge. It's huge. All right. The Monk's Mound, the southwest corner. All right. That's where we are. All right. I'm headed there, baby. All right, I'm gonna get at you when I get up there. I'm almost there. Ooh, it's been a challenge. Ooh, I know y'all hear me breathing. I'm on top of the world. I'm on top of the world. Where my ancestors were. All right. Let's check this out. You see that mound over there? That's where we were at first. All right. Here's the map. All right. Got the Grand Plaza, Twin Mounds. We're at the Grand Plaza, baby. Grand Plaza, baby. You can see the St. Louis Arch in the background. They got construction going on, but. Top of the mounds, baby, where my ancestors were, the Mississippian culture. Salute, salute, Ashe, ayo. And my baby, hey, we gotta go back that way. This is the Monk's Mound, so you know this should be like the spiritual center, which is where I want to be. The spiritual center. All right. So I could just flow in my inner medicine woman. All right. Oh, it's beautiful up here, y'all. It's so beautiful. All right. This is the monk's mound, the fourth terrace. Okay. This is where the last temple was, okay? It says excavation map of the last temple, okay? All right. Look at the butterfly. I'm psyched. See y'all in a minute. From the Cahokia Mounds, the city of the sun, the Mississippian culture. Ashe, ayo. Sacred pipe with the white calf buffalo woman on top of the mound, Cahokia Mounds. I want to say salute to my Mississippian ancestors. Thank you.
All praises to the Most High, the Creator of creators, the Framer and the Shaper of all. Heya heya. Love and light to my loved ones, the copper-colored faces, my melanations, and to the seekers of truth from other persuasions. As you can see, this episode is very revealing, and much of the truth in regard to the thousands of stone pyramids and pyramid mounds throughout North America is hidden in plain sight across the continent. And many of them have been destroyed by foreigners whose offspring and descendants call themselves Americans today. Just to know that much of what we've been told and led to believe is a fairy tale and a fantasy in comparison with the actual accounts. And the multitude of lies that are given to cover up the real truth is mind-boggling. It's a major shock to the cognitive dissonance and the programmed indoctrination. And coming from someone who has worked in the public school system for years, I can tell you that the indoctrination is real. This is one of the major motivations to reveal and to provide the hidden and concealed information and knowledge for our own examination of the facts and the truth. And I appreciate the support that I've received that has assisted in gathering of this information and the production of this presentation. I want to give a big shout out and a thank you to Sister Elisa Moon and family for your contribution. From our several email correspondences, I hope that this presentation is insightful and that it provides a face for the people in those records that are being held. And thank you to Brother Anthony for your contribution. The support from our sister and brother was a big help in the production and the soundtrack for this presentation. To show my appreciation, this segment is brought to you by Sister Elisa Moon and family and Brother Anthony. Thank you for supporting me in doing what I love to do, seek, research, and study. And to the Most High, all the glory. Now, although there is scientific confirmations and genetic evidence that the oldest Y chromosome DNA, said to be the father gene of all men, which predates the creation story or Adam creation, was found in America, South Carolina to be exact. And even though it is recorded in the histories by Herodotus that the Egyptians boasted that their ancestors in the West, the Americas, were the oldest men on earth. And despite all of the pre-conquest and pre-colonial American records, for example, the oldest codices that depict the original and oldest people, and never mind the archaeological evidence of massive stone head statues that are said to depict warriors of the mother culture of Mesoamerica that are found nowhere in the ancestral lands of the very people who perpetrate and pretend to have ancestry or kinship with today. Or the ancient murals, the carvings, the paintings, and many other depictions of the original Americans that the Alemanni, the Visigoths, the Suevi, the Lombards, the Franks, the Anglos, or the Usurpers of Europe, who became the usurpers of the Americas, first encountered in their historical accounts as they invaded North, South, and Central America, and how they described these people and who their offspring and descendants are today. None of the facts and truth presented in this presentation will ever be taught in public schools or any colleges, universities, or any institutions of education in perpetuity with the status quo. Meaning they, the powers that be, are not going to tell us that the people that have been historically displaced and reclassified multiple times, the people that a bulk of their laws were made to dehumanize, exterminate, and to perpetually bring harm against, these people are in fact the descendants of the ancient people that the early usurpers of Europe themselves call the American Aborigines. In fact, the ancestors of many of today's self-proclaimed white Americans who came to America from Europe with all of their ideologies and philosophies, they themselves admit that before history began, the so-called Negro was. Doesn't this exemplify the context and the meaning of the word Aboriginal? From the conclusion of several of their most learned and distinguished anthropologists, scientists, archaeologists, and historians, the Aboriginal of all races is the so-called Negro. So using common sense, if there is no date of origin for the existence of said so-called Negro, and archaic genetics are older than the time frame given to the biblical creation of mankind, wouldn't these archaic people, these so-called Negroes, and their offspring and descendants over eons be anywhere and everywhere on the face of the earth? In every inhabitable landmass, island, and peninsula? Wouldn't this explain why the oldest skeletal remains and artifacts of man found throughout the earth are said to be so-called Negro? There are even antique maps with India as the name of the Americas. These maps are centuries older than Bharat or Hindustan, before it was officially named India in 1947. To show you just how recent that was, that's the year my father was born. So it's not surprising to learn that the early Jesuit missionaries and conquistadors called the people that they encountered the Negros de Terra, or Blacks of the Land. According to the Jesuit letters and the conquistador journals of their own early American exploits, the term Negro and Indios was synonymous. And these Negroes and these Indios people in each of their respective countries or states throughout the Americas that they inhabited in pre-colonial times were also referred to as Aboriginals.
Aborigine, which means what? Black folks.
What?
Aborigines are called natives, or they're always dark-skinned people.
Yeah!
Well, you never find a white aborigine. You and I are aborigines.
One more important piece of the puzzle was found in 2005 when cancer researcher Keith Cheng was studying the black and white stripes of zebrafish.
There are a lot of zebrafish in my laboratory because I'm a geneticist and I study how mutations occur, which is how cancer occurs, and I use pigmentation to detect those mutations. By chance, the light skin-colored fish that I used for that research also taught us a lot about how Europeans, how humans became lighter skinned.
What Professor Cheng discovered was perhaps one of the most important genetic mutations ever found. A single change among literally billions of coded instructions within zebrafish DNA that reduced black pigment from their stripes. Soon after, this identical genetic mutation was found in fair-skinned Europeans.
There was a magic moment in this research. When I got back the results that showed that the number and the size and the amount of pigment in light-skinned zebrafish were all diminished, and the same thing happened in humans, when I opened the textbook and saw that same thing, I began to sweat. Not only did light-skinned people evolve from black-skinned people, but lighter-skinned people, whether they're European or whether they're Asian, like me, were actually mutants of the dark-skinned people.
This was remarkable because we had only inferred on the basis of circumstantial evidence that this must have occurred in evolution, but we didn't have any concrete genetic evidence. Now we do.
Aborigine, which means what? Black folks. Well, you never find a white aborigine. Aborigines are called natives, or they're always dark-skinned people. You and I are aborigines, but you don't like to be called an aborigine.
Walter Nevis is a physical anthropologist at Sao Paulo University in Brazil. He's been using a standard and reliable archaeological measure, the shape of the skull, to find out what race she belonged to.
91.
He fully expected Luthia to be a Mongoloid, an ancestor of the American Indians.
91.
But then he fed the measurements into the computer.
When we start running the computer and seeing the results, it was amazing because we realized that the statistics, the quantitative analysis we were doing was not showing these people to be Mongoloid. In fact, the analysis was showing these people as anything except Mongoloid.
So who was Luthia? And where did she come from? To find out, the skull was taken to a hospital in Rio de Janeiro to begin the process of reconstructing her face. The first stage was to make a three-dimensional CAT scan of Luthia's skull in order to build a replica. Was then given to Richard Neave of the University of Manchester in England, one of the world's leading forensic artists, to recreate her features.
To me, is a Negroid face that has all the features you associate with a Negroid face. The proportions of the face, it doesn't say anything about it being a Mongoloid.
With the confirmations by scientists from the fields of genetics and anthropology, such as Professors Keith Ching and Walter Neave, and one of the world's leading experts in forensic facial reconstruction, Richard Neave, just for clarification of what these scientific confirmations mean, let's look at a few facts that I've gathered to emphasize the point. Let's take a look at the etymology of the word aborigine and how it was and is applicable to the ancestors here in the Americas first. Okay, so the noun aborigine, person, animal, or plant that has been in the country or region from earliest times. Now, the singular of aborigines is actually aboriginal. Is considered the correct singular in English, and it means the first inhabitants. We can really start right there because according to the science, according to the confirmations, they tell you who the original people are, and so those would be the first inhabitants. And it goes on to say that it was especially of lithium, hence the first ancestors of the Romans, who, if you go into history and you research who they really were, the original Romans, or those who were the original Romans, they were melanated prior to them being sacked or conquered and usurped by barbarians. This is historical. So we can scroll down and let's look at the aboriginal. First, earliest existing from the beginning, especially in reference to inhabitants of lands colonized by Europeans. So that would basically include just about every melanation across the earth. So now when we're talking about Aboriginal people and who the Aboriginals are, that's kind of giving you clarification and confirmation, scientifically, as well as definition and etymology. Here's a map from 1613 by Michael Mercator, and it's an illustration of the Americas as India. America, Suevi, India Nova. Here is a cartage with a label on it, America, Suevi, India Nova. So this is proof that there are maps, antique maps, that list the Americas by the name of India. And here's a translation of the description that was written on the map, translated from Latin. In 1492, October, Christopher Columbus discovers New India in the name of Castile, who were the Spanish monarchs in Barcelona. And I can show you a picture that here's, I'll go ahead and show this one first. Found this another day and I thought this was kind of interesting. It was titled The First Dispute Between Christopher Columbus and the American Indian Over the Empire. And so I'm looking at this picture of the illustration of Columbus and the boats in the background. And then I'm looking at the indigenous people who he encountered and the phenotype and, you know, what they illustrated them as. And I'm looking at the complexion and I'm like, well, hey, wait a minute. This is about my complexion. So I'm like, this is pretty much a lot of truth in this depiction. And when you look at other depictions, say, well, for instance, this one, like this one, because it really gives you a real close actual account depicting how the people looked. This is Columbus being received in Barcelona after his first voyage. And according to history, he brought back around 1,500 of the natives. And so these are depictions of them illustrated. And you can see all shades of copper colored people. All shades, from the darkest brown to some of the lightest tan and tawny colors. So this is why they called them the copper color races, because they were copper colored as, say, these pennies. A native of America, originally applied to the Aboriginals, or copper colored races, found here by the Europeans and the hijack, but now applied to the descendants of the Europeans born in America. So when you're looking at some of the older antique prints and paintings, drawings, some of them giving the real spiel. They're depicting what really happened. They're depicting how the people really looked. And you can see right here, feather headdress, the fringes. Look, he has pineapples right here serving up. Look at the parrot. Two parrots right here. Oh, is that a parrot? And that's a quetzal. So this gives you a pretty good idea of how the people looked when Columbus brought them back to Barcelona. And here you have a portrait of the Virgin of the Navigators. And if you can look closely up under the cloak, you can see the Indians depicted right here. Like, this is supposed to be Columbus and some of his men or whatever. But here are the indigenous people that were brought back depicted. Which leads me to other accounts. Here's one, a historical account of Americans being kidnapped or being taken. Girolamo Benzoni was an Italian conquistador and merchant who wrote a popular account of his travels. In the 1550s, Benzino tells of his day that American captives were being traded for wine, flour, biscuits, and other merchandise, even including women made pregnant by their captors. Now, this source, of course, was quoted by Jack Forbes in his book, American Discoveries. But as I was doing some research into the topic, I come across some information, and I come across our actual print, and you can get a PDF, Histories of the New World by Girolamo Benzoni. Let me see if I can scroll down, find it. But it quotes it directly in the book. Okay, on page 11, let me blow it up a little bit, let me enlarge it. It reads, all the slaves that the Spaniards catch in these provinces are sent to Cubegue because the king's officers are in that island, who collect the royal revenues consisting of pearls, gold, slaves, and other articles. For a fifth of everything is paid, that is 20%. The slaves are all marked in the face and underarms by a hot iron with the mark of C. Then the governors and captains do as they like with them. Some are given to the soldiers, so that the Spaniards afterwards sell them or gamble them away among each other. When ships arrive from Spain, they barter these Indians for wine, flour, biscuits, and other requisite things. Let's move along. So, in 1606, William Janszoon, the captain of the Dutch East India Company ship, the Dufkin, discovered New Holland. Here's an illustration, and this is from the National Museum of Australia. Here's an illustration of his voyage and him finding New Holland, which was what the Dutch had named what is today Australia at the time, in 1606. This is when they first discovered the landmass, what is now Australia, and the inhabitants. 1606. It's important to note that the Dutch East India Company was said to be an early mega corporation throughout the 17th and the early 18th centuries that was founded by the Dutch government. Thank you. this mega corporation, the Dutch East India Company, had control over the trade, exploration, and colonization of the lands and the sea that the ancient Hindu called Ratnakar, and the Greeks called it Eritherean Sea, before it recently became known as the Indian Ocean. And the Dutch East India Company, the colonizers of the East Indies, were the predecessors of the Dutch West India Company, the colonizers of the West Indies, the Americas, or the original India. So the Dutch captain, William Janszoon, discovered New Holland in 1606. And as you can see on the map, this is New Holland. And the Dutch East India Company controlled all of the trade, exploration, and the colonization of the lands. Let's look in the Dictionary of Useful Knowledge. I came across a little information. It says Wales, New South Wales, a colonial territory pertaining to Great Britain and Australia, until within the last few years, dated from the present time of 1862, included all the discovered lands lying along the eastern seaboard of the continent of Australia or New Holland. So right here is evidence that the continent was called New Holland, named after the Dutch East India Company, in 1606, beginning in 1606, when that was discovered. So if it was discovered in 1606, and Christopher Columbus and other conquistadors came to the Americas in as early as 1492, as recorded, so it's not rocket science to figure out who they were pertaining to as Aborigines prior to this continent being discovered in 1606. And became a penal colony called New South Wales. And we can get a little information about that. On history.com, it states, this day in history, January 26, 1788, first Australian penal colony established. And it goes on to say, the first 736 convicts banished from England to Australia or New Holland, which now becomes New South Wales, land in Botany Bay. Over the next 60 years, approximately 50,000 criminals were transported from Great Britain to the land down under, and one of the strangest episodes in criminal justice history. So this is recorded by history.com that they were using New South Wales, that was formerly known as New Holland when it was discovered by the Dutch, now as a penal colony. So they're shipping the prisoners from Great Britain into New Holland, or now New South Wales. And they call it New South Wales because a lot of the prisoners were from Wales. So that's why they call it New South Wales. Here we have on the BBC.com, on their website, they have a little bit more information about Australia's penal colony roots. It says that New South Wales, a state in Southeast Australia, was founded by the British as a penal colony in 1788. Over the next 80 years, more than 160,000 convicts were transported to Australia from England, Ireland, Scotland, and Wales, in lieu of being given the death penalty. So right here, they were giving people an option. Either you can go ahead and take the death penalty, or we can ship you out. So according to this research that's stated here on BBC.com, over 160,000 were shipped over 80 years. So that gives you an idea of how Australia has become people by a lot of so-called Europeans or Xantracroid people. Now, according to the National Library of Australia, how was Australia named? It gives you a little map right here where it was being proposed to be called Australia or Terra Australis. But it says that it was the English explorer Matthew Flinders who made the suggestion of the name we use today. He was the first to circumnavigate the continent in 1803 and used the name Australia to describe the continent on a hand-drawn map in 1804. So that's when Australia, basically the name, the term Australia was introduced in the early 1800s by Matthew Flinders. It was called New South Wales. Prior to that, it was called New Holland, when it was discovered in 1606 by the Dutch. And according to Australian government, or australia.gov, Australia became an independent nation on the 1st of January 1901, when the British Parliament passed legislation allowing the six Australian colonies to govern in their own right as part of the Commonwealth of Australia. So this gives you the establishment of Australia, 1901. Okay, now let's recap. Now, the captain of the Dutch East India Company ship, William Jansoen, discovered the continent in 1606. It was New Holland. Years later, British came in and they made it a penal colony, and they started shipping a lot of their convicts or undesirables out of their continent into Australia, and it became known as New South Wales because a lot of those prisoners and those convicts were from Wales, a majority. And after that, in the 1800s, early 1800s, the name Australia was proposed. Now, about a century later, Australia became an independent nation in 1901. So this is important for us to know this history, because now when you're thinking about that term Aborigine, who would that be applying to prior to Australia being discovered in 1606? If they were already in Americas as early as 1492, even earlier than that, but we'll start at the 1492 mark. So that gives us all of this time prior to 1606. So who do you think that term was being referred to if it was in circulation in the 15 and the 1600s prior to them discovering this continent? That's something to keep in mind. Here's something else I want to go over real quick. Okay, Aboriginal Australia. As you can see in this picture, it depicts some of the indigenous Australian people that's on that continent, whose ancestors were on that continent. So you can look at their phenotype and you can say, oh yeah, those are Australian Aborigines. But here's the trickery. Let me scroll up. Now they're showing people that look like this, and they're calling Australian Aboriginal beauties. Well, clearly, there's a difference between this one and the, say this. This is what we would call, you know, the Aboriginal phenotype. These are what Aboriginals are. Aboriginal people. But they're trying to loosely apply that term to people who are mixed, that may have Aboriginal genetics, Aboriginal DNA. So we got to understand what's going on. When they're calling people that look like this Aboriginals, Now, it's a historical fact that Cristobal Colon, aka Christopher Columbus, and his crew invaded the West Indies of the Americas and raped, slaughtered, and subjugated the first inhabitants, or the aboriginals, and kidnapped thousands of these American aborigines in 1492. It is also a fact that the usurpers of Europe didn't discover the continent of Australia and its indigenous people until 1606. So if the word goes back to the 1540s, who was being referred to as aboriginals before Australia was discovered? According to etymology, the word aborigine was used in Australia to describe the original inhabitants of the land as early as 1789. That's right after the British found New South Wales in Southeast Australia as a penal colony in 1788. Over the next 80 years, more than 160,000 convicts were transported to Australia from England, Ireland, Scotland, and Wales in lieu of being given the death penalty. And in 1789, the term aborigine was extended to natives of other countries which Europeans have colonized, especially aboriginal inhabitants of Australia. Why? Because they were among the last of the aboriginals and all of the land masses on earth that have been colonized by the xanthrochoic usurpers of melanated civilizations. However, according to etymology, the word, specifically of Australian sense, as it is applied, is actually attested from 1820. The word aboriginal was then applied in the definition of the word American in 1828. Again, if the word aboriginal goes back to the 1540s, who was being referred to as aboriginals before New Holland was discovered in 1606 and before it was renamed to Australia in the 1800s? It only takes a little critical thinking and common sense. Now, admittedly, a lot of facts and information discovered in researching for this presentation really hit close to home with me, as my family ancestry stretches up the Mississippi, or Great River, from the territories that became Mississippi, Arkansas, Tennessee, and Illinois. For many of you, this information may be just as revealing, because my story is no different than millions of us melanated, copper-colored people in America today, especially for those who have ancestral roots in the Northeast, Southeast, the Mid-South, and the Midwest regions of North America. I was born and raised in Illinois, but all of my grandparents were born in the territories that became Tennessee and Mississippi, the ancestral lands of the Mississippians, named so for their relationship with the Mississippi, meaning Great River, or its transliteration, the Mississippi, because their cultures and civilizations spread over a great area of the Southeast and the middle of North America up the Mississippi River and into the river valleys of what are now the states of Mississippi, Alabama, Georgia, Tennessee, Kentucky, Arkansas, Missouri, Illinois, Indiana, Ohio, and into Wisconsin and Minnesota. The ancestors had several metropolises throughout these regions, but their main metropolis was Cahokia, which was said to be the biggest, most cosmopolitan city north of Anahuac or Mexico today. For clarity and historical timeline, it's important to know that the state of Tennessee was established in 1796. And here on the Tennessee Secretary of State website, as I scroll down, it tells you right here. After a close vote, on June 1st, 1796, Tennessee became the 16th state of the Union. So this occurred in 1796. And history.com shows us that Mississippi joined the Union as the 20th state in 1817. Now, before the statehoods of Tennessee and Mississippi, the lands were known as Indian territories. Before 1817, the territory that became Mississippi was the territory of Georgia. The state of Georgia claimed the entire region extending west from the Chattahoochee to the Mississippi River, and tried to sell lands there, most notoriously in the Yazoo land scandal of 1795. Georgia finally ceded the dispute area in 1802 to the United States national government. In 1804, after the Louisiana Purchase, the government assigned the northern part of this cession to Mississippi Territory. The southern part became the Louisiana Territory. A precursor to this was the Carolina Charter. In 1663, Charles II of England granted the land called Carolina to 8 Lord Proprietors, who controlled the Carolinas until 1729. On NorthCarolinaHistory.org, it gives us some information on the Carolina Charter of 1663. I'll scroll down where I was reading about these 8 men and their heirs and assigns were identified by the charter as the true and absolute Lord Proprietors of Carolina. They were to have use, exercise, and enjoy the colony in as ample a manner as any bishop of Durham in our kingdom of England. This meant that the Lord's proprietors possessed broad feudal powers to profit from the colony and bore the considerable responsibility of managing and protecting it in the interest of England. They were conferred full and absolute power for the good and happy government of the said province, including the power of enacting laws, legislative power, to duly execute the laws upon all people within said province, the executive power, and to impose penalties, imprisonment, or any other punishment, the judicial powers. The 1663 charter also included many other provisions. The Lord's proprietors were permitted to delegate their governmental powers to deputies, lieutenants, judges, justices, magistrates, officers, and members of their choosing. As extensive as the Lord Proprietor's powers were, the 1663 Charter included a number of provisions designed to guard against the abuse of those powers. Yeah, right. Anyway, as you can see, you have some information on the charter that was given to Carolina by King Charles II. However, before the Carolina Charter of 1663 that granted the Lord Proprietors the land, the original name of Carolina was Chicora. The Chicora were a tribe in the territory with a legendary American kingdom that was sought by various European explorers in present-day South Carolina during the 16th century. It is said that this legend originated after Spanish or Visigoth slave traders captured an American Indian, or Indios, whom they called Francisco de Chicora in 1521. After this, the Spanish Visigoths saw Francisco's home country of Chicora as a land of abundant wealth and natural resources. It is said that the Chicora legend influenced both the Spanish and the French in their attempts to colonize North America for the next 60 years. The territory of Carolina was said to be named after King Charles I and King Charles II of England. The name Carolina is said to have come from the Latin word Carolinus, meaning of Charles. Carolinas were known as the province of Carolina during America's early colonial period, from 1663 to 1710. Prior to that, the land was considered part of the colony and dominion of Virginia, from 1609 to 1663. During the colonialism, the tribes of the Carolinas included the Chicora, the Algonquin, Bear River Indians, Cape Fear Indians, the Catawba, the Cherie, the Eastern Band of Cherokee. The Chowanoc, the Machipunga, the Muratok, Natchez, Osinichi, Saponi, Shakori, Tuscarora, Chiquota, Congaree, and Waccamaw tribes. As I'm researching and studying this information and piecing it all together based on the actual historical accounts, I'm gaining a better understanding of what was really going on. As documented and recorded, the Visigoths, aka Spanish slave traders, were kidnapping and enslaving Americans in the 1500s. As in the case of the American from Chicora, who the Spaniards or Visigoths called Francisco. This kidnapping is consistent with the accounts of Girolamo Benzoni in the 1500s. In the book, The Natural and Aboriginal History of Tennessee, before the first settlements therein by white people in the year 1768, it gives a historical account of the origin and records of the Cherokees and the Aborigines or original people of the land. On page 231, chapter 10, it reads, "The history of the Cherokees will now receive an undivided attention, not only because in all their principal customs, religious notions, and political institutions, they differ in all respects from the Aborigines of Tennessee and Kentucky, but also because they and the subsequent parts of this narrative are the principal actors in the transactions which are to be detailed. We will consider first of the countries from whence they came, secondly of their military character, thirdly of their traditions, fourthly of their computation of time, fifthly of their Hebraic rites, and sixthly of their political government, laws, and civil customs. First, of the countries from whence they came. The truth is that although they set up a claim for the country upon the Cumberland and from thence to the Tennessee, they did not found it upon the expulsion of the Aborigines, but on driving the Shawnees from the River Cumberland. Their claim to the country was not a perfect one. It was only better in their own estimation than that which the Shawnees had. This fact became very apparent in the year 1766, when a treaty was made at Fort Sedgwick under the authority of King of Britain by Sir William Johnson, the King's agent for Indian affairs, with the Iroquois in the month of November in the same year. The latter there came all the land south of the Ohio as far as the Tennessee River. Okay, so by the Treaty of Fort Sedgwick, the Six Nations ceded all their rights southeast of the Ohio down the Cherokee River, which they stated to their just right, invested the soil and sovereignty thereof in the King of Great Britain by the Treaty of 1783. He resigned his sovereignty and dominion, leave the land to those states in whose limits they were. The Six Nations have a traditionary history which state them not to be the Aborigines of the country, but conquerors of the first possessors. The abandonment of the conquered tribes they relied on as the evidence necessary to perfect their title. The only one to be relied on in unlettered and savage negotiations. The right is that of conquest, acknowledged perfect among nations, when either a treaty at the end of the war confirmed it, or the conquered nation is wholly extinct, or flies to foreign countries, leaving theirs in the possession of their enemies. So what it's saying basically is that when the Cherokees came into the region that became Tennessee, there were other tribes, and the original tribes that were in the area were not Cherokees. Okay, so let me read this again. The Six Nations have a traditionary history which states them not to be the Aborigines of the country, but the conquerors of the first possessors. Well, basically what they're saying is that the Six Nations, who are they? They are the ancestors of the federally recognized tribes today, which are mostly of what we would call Mongoloid stock or Siberian DNA traced. So, those people who call or claim to be Native Americans, who are of those federally recognized tribes, the ancestors of all that was the Six Nations. And so right here, in the historical researches, is stating that they admit themselves, and they state them not to be the Aborigines of the country. So right here is evidence, admission. And we go to the next page here, where it says, if it be true that the Natchez once possessed all the country between the Iberville and the Wabash, and from the Mississippi to the Alleghenies, the conquest must have been made of them by the Iroquois and the Chickasaws, for the latter have claimed the land under Mississippi, and as far as to Tennessee, ever since they were known to us. The historical fact seems to be established that the people from the north overran and exterminated the Aborigines. Who are the Aborigines? Okay, well, we know that they're not the Six Nation people, because they are the ones who they're saying were possibly the ones who exterminated the Aborigines. So who are the Aborigines? Let me read it again. The Six Nations have a traditionary history which states them not to be the Aborigines of the country, but the conquerors of the first possessors. So you might ask, what's the significance of that? Medicine Man, what does that mean? Well, if you know who the Six Nations are, then you will understand the significance of it, because the Six Nations are actually the ancestors of the federally recognized tribes of today. I came across something pretty interesting from George Catlin, the famous painter who was known, historically known, for his portrayals of a lot of the tribes that he encountered in his travels in the 1800s. Well, I come across a book called Du Bois Catlin, My Life Among the Indians, by George Catlin. And I wanted to share a little bit. It kind of struck me. Let's start right here. There has been much speculation and great variety of opinions as to the results of the intercourse between the European and African population with the Indians on the borders. The finest built and most powerful men that I have ever yet seen have been some of the less mentioned, the Negro and North American mix of equal blood. These instances are rare, to be sure, yet are occasionally to be found among the Seminoles and Cherokees, and also among the Comanches, even, and the Caddoos. And I account for it in this way. From the slaveholding states to the heart of the country of a wild tribe of Indians, through almost impassable wilds and swamps for hundreds of miles, it requires a Negro of extraordinary leg as well as courage and perseverance to travel, stealing from his master's field to throw himself among a tribe of wild and hostile Indians in order to enjoy their liberty. Such a Negro, when he succeeded, was admired by the Indians, as they come with a good share of the tricks and arts of civilization. They are at once looked upon by the tribe as important personages, and generally marry the daughters of chiefs. And generally marry the daughters of chiefs. Wait a minute. Let me back up. So we're talking about Negroes. Negroes that find their way to a tribe, and they're so revered that when they are accepted into the tribe, obviously, they're so much and so accepted that generally they marry the daughters of chiefs, thus uniting with theirs the best blood in the nation. And thus are produced those remarkable, fine, and powerful men I have mentioned. So now when you hear about General Jessup saying that this is not an Indian war, it's a Negro war, you see what he's talking about. Because
historically, Aborigines are the Negroes. So when we're talking about the Aborigines were conquered or the Aborigines were exterminated or ran out, they're talking about the Negroes. But the fact remains, if the so-called Negro is still here and has always been, then the Aborigine never went nowhere. He just was conquered, or he just was subdued, or he just was reclassified. Paper genocide. And his title, his claim, his heritage, his lineage, his history, and somebody else claims that. You got, of course, sift through the dirt to get to gems, and I'm looking at this and I'm like, okay, come to sense. If it was a runaway slave and he wandered off off of a plantation or whatever, so is what this is supposing, and he encountered a tribe and the tribe welcomed him and was so revered and so that they gave him not the least of, you know, the women, you know, maybe, you know, a foot soldier of a foot soldier's daughter. No, he gets the chief's daughter. For real? They doing it like that? Really? Or is it that these people knew that these were the Aboriginals that were incarcerated or prisons of war? You know, if you go ahead and research the Chickamauga Wars all through Tennessee for over like 20 years, well, 19 years to be exact, when you research that, you'll see that what was going on. So when these people were captured, who you think they were? What were they called? And if the Six Nations or the ancestors of the federally recognized tribes today saying that they ain't the Aborigines of this country and that they conquered the Aborigines or exterminated the Aborigines or assisted in their reclassification and I'm assuming their identity, then you see how the game is being played. I mean, you know, as you dig, it just becomes more and more obvious. It's like the further and further I go back, the more truthful these people are. They just telling it just like it was. You know, that's, you know, so there's really no speculation. It's really no, you know, debating it. I mean, you're basically telling me that they're lying. Because I'm not saying it. I'm repeating what I've read. I'm repeating what they stated, what they've documented, what they've recorded. That's all I'm doing. I'm just repeating it. So if you calling me a lie, no, you ain't. You calling them a lie. They the ones who recorded it. They the ones who said it. They the ones who stated it. The Six Nations, the ancestors of the federally recognized tribes of today. They said that they're not the Aboriginals of this land, that they conquered the Aboriginals. So if you see these so-called Negroes still walking around and their descendants still rocking around today, and you know that historically, only people historically that's been called Aborigines are so-called Negro or Negro phenotype people. Period. Let's not get, you know, get it twisted when we want to get, you know, lighter complected or pale skinned or Zedricorg looking people that are in these lands now. Oh, no, I'm an Aborigine. No, that ain't how it work. No, let's not do that. And let's keep it real. Let's keep it 100. I mean, through assimilation, intermixing, you know, yeah, you may have acquired some of that DNA, some of that phenotype, but no, you're not the stock, you're a piece of it. And all that's doing is basically further deplacing the people who identity is taken. I'm like, can we give these people? They do. I mean, it's long overdue. Can we give them their due? These are so-called Aboriginal people. The ones that are off or away from the original people. Who were formed, of course, according to, if you want to look at it scripturally, they were formed from the dust of the earth. Thus, they were dust-colored people. So who are walking around today that are closer to dust-colored people than anybody else? Then, I mean, it's just common sense. It don't take much critical thinking. It's just common sense. So then we understand who Aboriginals are, period. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. You know, we know who it is. So in history, when they're referring to these people, we understand that these terms that are given to us, a lot of you can have probably 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 terms mean the same thing. Negro, Indios, Aboriginal, all this mean the same thing. They're the same people. Same phenotype, same group of people. So when they're talking about natives, indigenous, those are terms that were applied to these people originally. Not people that just ancestors have recently moved into a land and, oh, we've been here for a few hundred years, so we're indigenous or we're native. No. I mean, anybody can be native once you're born into a country. I mean, a native is just a denizen. A denizen is an English subject, period. Now you see what the game is all about. You got federally recognized tribes who call themselves natives. Yes, they're natives because they're denizens, they're English subjects. That's why they're federally recognized. Hello? A lot of it is just common sense. I mean, sometimes I just break it down so you can really see what I'm saying. But some of it, you know, some of it I shouldn't have to. So if the mound builders came before these other tribes, were they aboriginals? It says here, as a corn-based economy grew in the fertile Mississippi Valley, providing a reliable food source all year, populations rose and villages grew. About 1000 AD, Cahokia underwent a population explosion. So we can see that maize, corn, was being transferred up and down the Mississippi, and Cahokia as a metropolis was one of the major cities or major centers. Along with corn, Cahokians cultivated goosefoot, amaranth, canary grass, and other starchy seeds. Preserved seeds of these species have been found in excavations at Cahokia. Although the people farmed without the wheel or draft animals, corn production soared, and surpluses may have been stored in communal granaries under mounds. Here's some interesting information from the Wisconsin Archaeologist, volumes 19 through 20. And it gives some references on corn being grown as far up north as Wisconsin, showing how it traveled up the Mississippi as far up as to Wisconsin. So it goes on to say that there were Potawatomi villages near Forest Home Cemetery at the intersection of Muskego and Forest Home Avenues. The Potawatomi were collected by Jacksville at the Indian Fields near the Layton House in 1838 by the authority of the Treaty of Chicago, 1833, where they were fed until teams and supplies could be collected for the long overland journey to Council Bluffs, Iowa. Potawatomi villages were also located in present Wauwatosa. The Potawatomi visited the city of Milwaukee in numbers as late as 1880. The city and the county of Milwaukee has been a rich field for the archaeologists as thousands of artifacts have been found. In 217 mounds and numerous cornfields and village sites described. A score of smallpox ran through the Indians of the state in 1832-33. At Milwaukee, Jacques Vieux, stationed there as a trader, was busy most of the winter burying the natives. With a crooked stick inserted under a dead Indian's chin, they will haul the infected corpse into a shallow pit and give it a hasty burial. Antoine LeClaire, a trader at Milwaukee, writes that the Indians at Milwaukee 1800 cultivated about 5 acres of corn to each family, which was rudely fenced from their ponies. They grew sweet corn, pumpkins, beans, melons, and potatoes. They had neither cows nor hogs. They used no plow but hoed the ground. The wild game there was deer, bear, and muskrat. There was no elk or buffalo. Now we're talking about in Wisconsin, up north. It says that Andrew J. Vau says Indian ponies grazed, 1834, in great droves under Janu Marsh. The Indian cornfields were on Spring Street. A personal recollection of Mr. Charles E. Brown to the author says, the Potawatomi were the first Wisconsin Indians whom I knew as a boy. So right here it gives you some historical account of corn, maize, being grown as far north as Wisconsin up to Mississippi. So now when we're going and we're looking at these accounts and we're putting the pieces together and we're throwing around terms like Aborigines and Natives, we got to understand that there are two different things. The Aborigines were the people who were here before the Natives arrived. And according to history, according to science, those people were historically the dark melanated people or the so-called Negroids across the earth. So when we're talking about these terms, then we got to understand who are the people being referred historically. Anytime you hear the term Aborigine, especially during these times in the 1800s, when it was used a lot more so then than it is now, when you look back at those references and the people that they were referring to, they were always so-called Negroid or dark melanated people. Never pale, never xanthochroic, always melanated, dark-complected people. And different land masses on the earth. So that's where the original reference or the original context of that term was applied. And when we understand that when conquistadors, Jesuit priests, when they first came, the Visigoths, the Suevi, the Lombards, when they first arrived, and they encountered the people, what they called them. Negros de Terra, Indios, Aborigines. These are all adjectives, nouns, terms that they were using to describe the people that they encountered. And when they're talking about, oh, well, Columbus, you know, he got lost and, you know, he was looking for India and he thought he landed in India when he came over here in America, so he called the people Indians. Okay, now we have a better understanding of that whole ordeal. Thank you. Cristobal Colón, aka Christopher Columbus, he was in search of India, the original India, which was the Americas, because we have antique maps, historical references of these lands of America being referred to as India prior to Bharat or Hindustan being named so in 1947. So we got to understand how these timelines and these events or the sequence of events occurred and put them in proper perspective so we can get the better picture or the true picture. So now he was coming over here looking for the Indians. He was calling these people Indios because he knew he was in India. This was the ancient India, or what they were calling the East Indies. Over there, this was the West Indies over here. Now we have a better understanding of the East Indies and the West Indies. And we understand that the Dutch were colonizing. They had a monopoly over the whole thing initially. So they were colonizing the East Indies all over there in the what was now the Indian Sea, but used to be in antiquity, the Hindu, they referred to it as Ratnakar, and the Greek referred to it as the Eritrean Sea. That whole region, the whole area, all of those lands they were colonizing, and they had basically free reigns of exploration, you know, had control over it all. And they expanded. So then after this, they expanded to the West Indies, which was the Americas. And they formed their triangle of trade. So now we have to understand how these historical references, what they mean. So yes, we understand now that Cristobal Colón, aka Christopher Columbus, was coming to the Indies or India, and he was looking for us or the ancestors here in the Americas. He knew what he was doing. He knew where he was coming. And he knew what to call the people when he got here. That's why he referred to them as such, as Indios. Because they were in the land of India. And this is before Bharat or Hindustan was called India, and before it was established as India in 1947. So now we got to keep things in context, you know, so now we can have everything in a better perspective. Now we have a better overview, outlook of what happened and how the turn of events has shaped and formed our reality today. Keep in mind that through a lot of the laws, a lot of the agreements that were made, you know, you got to understand if there were records about people here in this land. We have books about the Aboriginals, the Aboriginal histories of the people of the Americas. And in these books, when they're talking about the Aboriginals, they are separating them from other tribes who came after. So now we got to understand that it was a group of people that were the original inhabitants of the land that they're saying were somehow exterminated or ran off or they just disappeared. Same stories they say about the Mayans, same stories they say about ancient civilizations like the Olmecs. These people didn't die off. These people, you know, they're still among us today. Some of the descendants are still among us today. Some of the offspring, some of the descendants of these ancient American civilizations are walking among us today. We have to understand this. And stop going with the yokey dope and stop believing, oh, we from somewhere else. Well, no. Everything points right here underground, up under your feet. Everything points right here. Again, if the word aboriginal goes back to the 1540s, who was being referred to as aboriginals before New Holland was discovered in 1606 and before it was renamed to Australia in the 1800s? It only takes a little critical thinking and common sense.